everyone. And thank you for coming this afternoon to a very special program in conjunction with the exhibition Through Vincent's Eyes, Van Gogh and His Sources. Thank you for those of you in the auditorium for wearing your masks throughout the program. I'm not wearing my mask because I'm 6 feet in distance from the nearest person to me. And it gives me a great pleasure to welcome to the stage Dr. Andrew Shelton, who received his BA summa cum laude from Columbia University and his MA and PhD from New York University's Institute of Fine Arts. He taught at Dartmouth College, the University of Delaware, and the Massachusetts College of Art before joining the faculty of the Department of History of Art at The Ohio State University, where he has taught 18th and 19th century European art since 1999. He's written two books and numerous articles and essays on the French painter Jean-Auguste Dominique Ingres, and is now working on a series of essays examining queer masculinities in 19th century French art and visual culture. Hello as well to those of you listening to us streaming online, and will everybody, whether at home or here, please join me in welcoming to the stage Dr. Andrew Shelton.
Thank you, David, for that very kind introduction. Thank you all for coming out to see Van Gogh on such a wintry Saturday. It's truly a pleasure for me to speak about Van Gogh with you here today in conjunction with such an extraordinary exhibition of his work and the work of the artist that he derived so much joy and inspiration from. That being said, I must admit that the prospects of lecturing on Van Gogh is quite a daunting proposition because the artist has been the subject of so much myth-making over the 130 years since his premature demise in 1890. And he's also been the subject of continuous art historical controversies, with the result that it's very difficult to say almost anything about Van Gogh or his art that isn't subject to refutation. Two controversies in particular have roiled the scholarship on the artist in recent years. One is of recent derivation, the other is quite longstanding. To address the most recent one first, in 2011, a biography, the definitive biography most people feel of Van Gogh came out. And in that biography, the authors argued that Van Gogh did not commit suicide in a wheat field by shooting himself, as has long been assumed, but rather that he was murdered, either intentionally or otherwise, by two teenage miscreants who we know had teased and tortured the artist throughout his time at Auvers, which was a little village north of Paris, where Van Gogh relocated in the spring of 1890. This claim that Van Gogh did not kill himself has not set well with many art historical experts on the artist who continue to insist that Van Gogh died from a self-inflicted gunshot wound. To my mind, much of the evidence surrounding this episode is quite complex, is very controversial, not so much controversial as circumstantial, and really can be marshaled in favor of either hypothesis. So as far as I can tell, the jury is still out on the method through which Van Gogh met his demise. The second more long-standing controversy for me is much more crucial to try to come to terms with in order for us to understand Van Gogh and his art. And this involves the nature of the artist's mental illness and the extent that it impacted his art. Over the years, everything from epilepsy to bipolar disorder to schizophrenia have been proposed as the ailment from which the artist suffered. Finally, in order to once and for all put an end to all of the speculation, in 2016, a symposium of psychiatrists, doctors, and art historians was convened at the Great Van Gogh Museum in Amsterdam to try to figure out what the artist actually suffered from. However, no firm conclusions were reached other than they seem to have ruled out schizophrenia. What was clarified, however, are the list of symptoms from which the artist suffered. These included optical and acoustic hallucinations. Van Gogh saw things and heard voices, delusions, hyperexcitation, confusion, incoherent speech, and the inability to remember many of these episodes. So he effectively had blackouts. Whatever the cause of these episodes, what I think what is particularly important for us to keep in mind, and I'm certainly not the first person to emphasize this, is that Van Gogh's attacks were periodic and they were of relatively short duration. And during these attacks, the artist often flew into violent rages in which he tried to hurt other people or more often himself. Is what caused the infamous episode in December 1882. After a fight with his friend and artist Gauguin, Van Gogh sliced off a part of his ear. And here we see him in this famous self-portrait with his ear bandaged. On other occasions, we know that Van Gogh tried to eat his paint or drink his turpentine if he were having one of these mental breakdowns. The upshot to all of this, and what I think is particularly important for us to keep in mind, is that Van Gogh was all but incapable of painting when he was having his most violent attacks. Indeed, when he was institutionalized in an asylum in Saint-Rémy in 1889, he was only allowed to have access to his painting materials when he was acting rationally, when he was lucid. Thus, far from being the primary vehicle through which Van Gogh expressed his mental instability, his insanity, a painting was, at least during that crucial period of his hospitalization, and I think during other periods as well, painting was for Van Gogh a kind of lifeline to his sanity, something that he could only do when he was rational and lucid. And all this leads me, and of course many others, to believe that we do a great disservice to Van Gogh when we think of him as he was famously portrayed in the bestseller and blockbuster movie Lust for Life as some kind of mad genius, an artist who was absolutely compelled to create spontaneously and unthinkingly by mental or spiritual forces beyond his control, a man, in short, who was enthralled by his uncontrollable, irrational genius or talent. For even though Van Gogh undoubtedly had moments of great inspiration, and we also know that he tended to paint at a kind of breakneck speed that often amazed and sometimes annoyed his colleagues, I would suggest that the majority of the paintings that we have from Van Gogh were the result of careful thought, even calculation. For even though Van Gogh was entirely self-taught as an artist, he turned out to be a very good teacher. He was able to understand, to master, and to adopt for his own purposes a variety of pictorial idioms that he encountered during his short career. And that is the foundation, I believe, of his achievement, not some mad inspiration. And this brings me to another aspect of Van Gogh's personality or character that I think has consistently been undervalued, at least in more popular representations of the artist, and that is his vast intelligence. Because even though Van Gogh was not a very good student, far from it, he turned out to be an incredibly intelligent individual. He read voraciously, and he was up to date on all the latest literary trends in 19th century literature. He was also a brilliant linguist. He spoke, read, and could write fluently in four languages, his native Dutch, of course, French, English, and German. And Van Gogh famously was almost as good a writer as he was a painter. He wrote a letter seemingly almost every day of his life, mostly to his younger brother, Theo, who was an art dealer in Paris and who provided Van Gogh's material and spiritual support for most of his life. But he also wrote to his artist friends, most notably Emile Bernard and of course, Gauguin. And Van Gogh's letters are distinguished by their absolute intelligence, and sometimes their almost heart-rending poignancy. They are a kind of monument to the Western epistolary tradition in and of themselves. But it is not Van Gogh's fierce intelligence that I want to focus on here today, but rather another prominent characteristic, a personality trait, indeed perhaps the defining characteristic of his personality, at least early in life, before he became so beaten down by feelings of loneliness and alienation. And that is the deep sense of empathy that Van Gogh developed for almost anyone who came into his orbit, particularly if he deemed them to be suffering in any capacity. The more downtrodden the individual, the more they suffered, the more tightly Van Gogh tended to embrace them. Now, I think a major source of Van Gogh's incredible capacity for empathy was his deeply religious upbringing. Van Gogh was born the eldest son of a Protestant minister in the Netherlands, and the artist at one point aspired to follow in his father's footsteps, but his impatience with the religious bureaucracy and the fanaticism of his religious beliefs made that impossible for him to do. And Van Gogh would eventually end up turning his back on organized religion altogether, but nevertheless, I believe that several of the most important tenets, beliefs of Protestantism remained with him throughout his life. Now, when I teach the introductory art survey at Ohio State, I have to teach Reformation art, and I always present this print by Albrecht Dürer, the great German Renaissance artist, who was in fact an artist that Van Gogh knew and admired. And this particular print illustrates the Last Supper, but more specifically, it illustrates Christ delivering the following words to his disciples. A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. So this basically establishes love for one's fellow human being as the essence of Christianity. And I can think of no other artist who followed this command, either intentionally or unintentionally, than Van Gogh. Van Gogh fell desperately in love with a series of women he encountered early on in his life, and he tended to idolize his friends, to smother them with devotion and affection. And to me, the greatest tragedy of Van Gogh's short life is that this love was rarely reciprocated. Almost all of Van Gogh's relationships tended to be short-lived, as his friends or his would-be lovers grew weary of his smothering affection and his slovenliness and his increasingly erratic behavior, which tended to be fueled by alcoholism late in life. In fact, Van Gogh's only sustained relationship was with his younger brother, Theo, but that relationship was largely long distance. It was largely conducted through correspondence. Now, with respect to our current exhibition, Van Gogh's enormous capacity for empathy also informed his artistic taste, as he tended to like artists who similarly demonstrated empathy for the downtrodden. And his attachment to this characteristic, to this subject, tended to take precedence over stylistic or formal considerations, with the result that many of the artists that Van Gogh most admired would have been considered outrageously retardataire, old-fashioned by his fellow avant-garde artist at the end of the 19th century. And in fact, posterity has largely agreed with Van Gogh's, not Van Gogh, but with his critics, as a number of the artists that Van Gogh loved the most had long been relegated to the dustbins of art history. Among Van Gogh's earliest artistic heroes and sources of inspiration for him were illustrators whose works he encountered in English illustrated magazines. And he was particularly taken to the ones that documented the sufferings of the poor. A work such as this, which a copy is in the exhibition, a work by Luke Field, Houseless and Hungry. This was published in the illustrated magazine, The Graphic, in 1869. Van Gogh actually owned a mounted copy of this print, and he praised it in a letter to Theo. Here we see a group of people who are lined up outside a 19th century version of a homeless shelter. And you can see that the print provides us a rather heartrending and relatively unsanitized view of the misery and suffering of a cross-section of the urban poor. So we see young derelicts and old drunkards, entire families, and what appear to be single mothers. And you might notice there at the extreme left, there's a top-hatted gentleman and a policeman. So order must be maintained as charity is being dispensed. Works such as these prompted Van Gogh early on in his career to actually aspire to be an illustrator. They inspired him to make a number of drawings and prints in The Hague, where he has his first real important phase as an artist. Here, for instance, are two works that Van Gogh executed during his years in The Hague in the early 1880s. One, an impoverished mother holding what appears to be a sick child. That is a drawing. And then over here on the right is actually a lithograph of an inhabitant of an old man's retirement home, where Van Gogh got a number of his subjects during these years. And basically what he did is just scoured the poor districts of The Hague in search of subjects. And even though Van Gogh's activities were more or less directly informed by these English illustrations, you can see that the similarities between Van Gogh's drawings and this lithograph and the art that inspired it, the similarities are really quite generic. Basically, they're graphic and they're black and white. I think the thing that really differentiates Van Gogh from the English illustrations is a matter of viewpoint or perspective. You can see that Field, even though he's clearly motivated by sympathy for these down and out people, he gets close enough for us to see them, but not, we might say, to smell them. He keeps a certain distance. This is not true of Van Gogh, who zeroes in on a small group of people or individuals and intensely records their physiognomies. So whereas Fields might be seen as giving us a kind of spectacle, producing a spectacle of poverty, Van Gogh gives us a series of intimate portraits of impoverished individuals. And this was likely the result of the fact that Van Gogh was living side by side with these types of subjects. The two individuals that you see in the drawing there on the left were actually members of Van Gogh's own household for a short time. Because as he was scouring the working class districts of The Hague in search of subjects, he came across the woman that you see there, whose name is Closina Hornick. Her nickname was Sane. She worked as a seamstress and supplemented her meager income with prostitution. Van Gogh hired her and her daughter and other members of her family to model for him. Over the course of doing that, the two became lovers. And Van Gogh declared his intentions to marry her, much to the horror of his friends and his family. It turned out that Hornick was actually pregnant when Van Gogh met her, and she delivered the child, the boy, and it seems that Van Gogh had every intention to raise that child as his own. So what Van Gogh was attempting to achieve here is like a nuclear, the bourgeois ideal of a nuclear family. Hornick had only limited interest in this goal. However, she eventually fell back to drinking and prostituting herself, and so the relationship with Van Gogh was ruptured. In terms of the style of these two drawings, they would have been deemed hopelessly crude and amateurish according to standards of the time. Here again, we're reminded that Van Gogh is largely a self-taught, but it seems to me with their kind of craggy outlines and the hard, almost wooden modeling, they're wonderfully expressive of their impoverished subjects. It's almost as if the style of the drawings are partaking of some of the rudeness, the raggedness, maybe even the filth of their subjects. Now, by the end of 1883, Van Gogh, who still was basically an unemployed artist, had to move back in with his parents, who were living in the Dutch town of Neunen. And there, Van Gogh, always attracted to the down and out, became fascinated with the peasants who lived around his parents' house. He spent hours upon hours observing them, either working in the fields or going about their daily routines in their hovels. Van Gogh's interest in the peasants as a subject was undoubtedly art historically motivated, because several of the artists that Van Gogh most admired specialized in representations of peasants and other rural workers. The artist that Van Gogh seems to have admired more than others was the mid-century realist painter Jean-François Millet, who specialized in these rather monumentalized representations of peasants. And sometimes, but not always, sometimes they had a kind of sentimental strain to them. As you can see from these two works, which are two of Millet's most famous, a version of the one on the left is included in the exhibition, Millet tended to approach his peasants or represent his peasants more as types than individuals. As you can see here, we can rarely see their faces. And if sometimes Millet's peasants are rudely dressed and seem dirty, they rarely, sometimes, but relatively rarely, do they seem to be in a truly desperate state of impoverishment. When Millet was working, originally producing these peasant pictures during the middle decades of the 19th century, peasantry was actually a very inflammatory theme to be specializing in politically. But Millet always denied the political meaning that was read into his pictures. Instead, he gave his work a biblical interpretation. He said that collectively his work tended to illustrate the maxim from the Bible, from Genesis, that man is destined to earn his bread from the sweat of his brow. So Millet imbued his work with a kind of religious fatalism that was tailor-made for the consumption of an artist of Van Gogh's disposition. Another painter, peasant painter that Van Gogh idolized, probably second only to Millet, was Jules Breton. And here you see two works by him. Breton's figures, mostly female, have the same kind of monumentality that we see in Millet's works, but the execution of his paintings are much more conventional in opposition to those encrusted surfaces of Millet's works. Breton's brushwork tends to be absolutely invisible, the picture plane transparent. This would have met with the approval of the most demanding academic artist. Breton also goes further than Millet in kind of sugarcoating the plight of the peasants. In Breton's work, rarely are peasants shown actually working, but more often they're seen resting or coming or going to the fields, as you see there, or participating in religious ceremonies, as we see over here on the left. So they're rarely shown actually working, and they're also tend to be cleaned up and even pretty. But none of this was enough to spoil Breton for Van Gogh. He so admired the artist that he made a pilgrimage to the little town in which Breton worked, and that was taken mostly on foot because he ran out of money, and he actually saw the studio in which Breton worked, but he was too shy to actually introduce himself. Now, however admiring Van Gogh was of the works of Millet and Breton, when he himself turned to paint a peasant subject, his works tended to look very, very different. And here is the culmination of Van Gogh's engagement with the peasant subject and what most scholars, I think, would consider his first great masterpiece, the famous Potato Eaters from 1885. And it shows a family of peasants who are settling down to their humble evening meal of steaming potatoes and piping hot coffee. The peasant repast was by no means an unprecedented subject in 19th century painting. It was a favorite motif of a contemporary Dutch artist that we know that Van Gogh knew and admired, Joseph Israels. Here is his peasant family at their table from 1882. This is when Van Gogh was in The Hague and Israels worked in The Hague. He's usually identified as a member of the Hague School. And so this Van Gogh probably saw this picture and may have had it somewhere in the back of his mind when he took up the Potato Eaters, but you can see the results are quite different. The only similarity really is a group of peasants seated around a table in a rather dark and dingy interior, although I would say that the interior in the Van Gogh is much less inviting than the one that we see in the Israels, which is more charmingly appointed, let's say. We can see cookware on display at the top over the fireplace, such kind of homey details as the discarded shoes, the wooden shoes, and a purring cat who sits contentedly before what is undoubtedly a bowl of warm milk. We don't see those kinds of niceties in Van Gogh's work. But where the artists really part ways is their approach to the figure and how they conceive of a peasant family. You can see that Israel shows us a conventional nuclear family. There's a mother and a father and three children. Van Gogh, however, presents us with an assemblage that consists mostly of adults. The woman or the figure in the front that we see from behind looks like she may be a child, a teenager. But the fact that the painting is dominated by adults suggests that these are members of an extended family who, because of their poverty, have to share a single abode. And then look at the way that the figures are painted, the way their flesh is described. In Israel's, we see light-skinned, ruby-cheeked individuals, which is what we would expect from the native population of the Netherlands. With Van Gogh, we see something quite different. Figures are consistently a dark skin, and look how the skin kind of barely stretches over their skulls. They seem quite emaciated. We might even wonder if this is their only meal of the day. We don't have such worries for the figures in the Israels. So what to make of this dark complexion that Van Gogh gives his figures? It's hard to say whether this is the result of their having spent untold hours out laboring in the fields under the hot burning sun, or if they're just kind of permanently dirty. Indeed, even though we know that Van Gogh spent untold hours with these peasants and was rumored to have impregnated one, and this rumor got him kicked out of his family's house once and for all, when Van Gogh was attacking this subject, I think this is the one instance in which his empathy falters a bit. And I think this gets expressed in the darkened complexions of those individuals. In his letters to Van Gogh, in his letters to Theo Van Gogh, Van Gogh describes peasants as leading, quote, an entirely different way of life than that of us civilized people, unquote, and as forming a world apart. Van Gogh often frequently qualifies them with the word black. They're dark to him. At one point, he describes them as forming a black avenging army. And what I suspect is happening here is that Van Gogh, however long much time he's spending with these peasants, he's not living with them. He's living in the very conventionally bourgeois home of his parents. And so this must have continuously reminded him that he was in a very fundamental way different from those peasants. And it was quite conventional in the 19th century to think of people of different classes almost as being from different species. And so people of the lower impoverished classes were often thought to be just fundamentally different from the members of the bourgeoisie. All that being said, I can't resist showing you two portraits that Van Gogh executed in preparation for the potato eaters. And you can see here that when he confronts another individual one-on-one, his empathy resurfaces. He treats his subjects as equals and as uniquely distinct individuals, refusing either to generalize or to sentimentalize them, as so many of his colleagues and predecessors were doing. Both of these are enormously moving to me anyway, in their individuality, in the directness and the forthrightness of these peasants' gazes. There seems to me to be a kind of permanent sadness and perhaps an expression of resignation in the uneven eyes of the woman and what I imagine to be her permanently turned down a mouth. And this is quite different with the boy, a young man who there seems to be a kind of note of mischief and jocularity on his face, as if he has not yet been beaten down by the continuous trials of life of poverty. There still seems to be a sparkle in his eye. So even though we know these figures only as peasants, we don't know their names, their identity is lost to us, they nevertheless survive as portraits in the truest possible sense of having captured the unique individuality of another human being. Now, when Van Gogh sent, getting ahead of myself, when Van Gogh sent the potato eaters to his art dealing brother Theo in Paris, Theo and everybody else were utterly appalled by what they saw. Not so much by the subject matter, as depressing as it was, but by the crudity of the style. Again, nothing like this was on view in Paris. The other thing that would have been so apparent to them is how out of step Van Gogh was with the latest trends and Parisian art making. We're in the middle of the 1880s. Impressionism has almost come and gone. I'm sure that Impressionism is all about light and color and recording the leisure of the moneyed classes. It's not about the suffering of the rural poor. And so when Van Gogh follows the potato eaters and turns up on Theo's doorstep, basically unannounced, in the spring of 1886, he has a lot of learning to do. He has a lot of catching up to do. But he was initially not very impressed with this type of art. He later recalled thinking that the works of the Impressionists were, quote, careless, ugly, badly painted, badly drawn, bad in color, everything that's miserable, unquote. It did not take him long to change his mind, however, and in fact, within 2 short years that he spent in Paris, Van Gogh totally reformed, modernized, updated his manner, mastering the stylistic and thematic foundations not only of Impressionism, but even of post-Impressionism, which first emerges in the pointillism of Seurat's great Grand Jatte, the painting in Chicago. Here is Van Gogh kind of trying his hand at pointillism. He doesn't go far with that because he just doesn't have the patience. He masters what was going on in Paris, and then this becomes the foundation for the emergence of his own mature style, which happens when he moves south to Arles in early 1888. Van Gogh moved to Provence, not for the weather, as we might imagine, but he was in search of a geographical surrogate for Japan, because Van Gogh, like virtually all avant-garde artists artist of the second half of the 19th century, was fascinated with Japanese art, and he believed falsely that the greatness of Japanese art lay in the fact that Japanese people lived in greater harmony with nature than their overly civilized Western counterparts. Shortly after he reached Arles, however, Van Gogh fixated on another idea, and that is he wanted to establish a kind of artist commune. It was going to be called the Studio of the South. It was going to be financed by Theo, and Gauguin was going to be the leader of this studio. Van Gogh referred to him as the abbot. The first thing that had to be done in order to get the Studio of the South up and running was that Gauguin had to be convinced to move to Arles. He was elsewhere in France. He did not want to go. But finally, after Theo essentially bribes him to go to Arles, he arrives in October of 1888. And despite Van Gogh's enormous adulation of Gauguin, who was prone to flattery, to be sure, the two men simply could not get along. Their ideas about art, their personal habits, they were just not made to spend time together. And it's that violent row with Gauguin in December of 1888 that prompts Van Gogh to engage in that famous episode of self-mutilation that I have already referred to. This episode also prompts Gauguin to abruptly leave Van Gogh, plunging the artist into the most desperate loneliness that was pretty much going to be his lot for the rest of his life. And I believe this chronic loneliness from which Van Gogh suffered prompted an important shift in his art, one in which all of the empathetic impulses that we saw displayed in his paintings of other human beings or earlier on in his life are transferred to non-human entities, to nature, to rooms, even to articles of clothing and pieces of furniture. They're all full of emotion. Because even though Van Gogh continued to engage in figure painting, and some of his most celebrated figure paintings come from the period in Arles and beyond, to me, they are deprived of all of that empathy that we saw in his early drawings and paintings, basically before he comes to Paris. Here are two of Van Gogh's most celebrated mature figure paintings. They're actually portraits, but you can see that it's the daring formal choices that that the artist is making that overshadows his characterizations of the sitters, who, to my mind, I come across as kind of detached and aloof. And this is also a function of a kind of peculiar theory of portraiture that Van Gogh had. Van Gogh believed that the future of art lay in portraiture, the genre of portraiture, but only if the sitters in those portraits were treated as types, not as individuals. For Van Gogh, the modern portrait had to transcend the particularities of the person that was posing for it. And just thus, we see the kind of generalizations of these figures, almost their allegorization. So Madame Roland becomes La Berceuse, so she becomes maternity, motherhood. And over there, the gypsy woman becomes a kind of exoticized other. And you can see that both of the faces of these people become kind of frozen and mask-like by the denaturalized color and brushwork that Van Gogh is now employing. Infinitely more moving and poignant to my eyes is a pair of ersatz portraits that Van Gogh executed of himself and Gauguin in the form of these strangely soulful pictures of the two chairs in which the two men sat habitually during their short time together in the famous yellow house in Arles. Van Gogh's chair is the one on the left. You can see it's a simple rush-bottomed affair. This was actually one of 12 chairs that Van Gogh purchased to accommodate all of the artists that were going to come to Arles and become part of the Studio of the South. The only other attributes that we see in his portrait is a pouch of tobacco, his pipe, and then there in the background, a box of onions where Van Gogh signs his name. And all of this is meant to suggests the famed humility and poverty of the artist. Gauguin's chair is a much fancier affair. You can see it's an elaborately wood carved chair that Van Gogh purchased expressly for Gauguin to occupy in the studio of the South. So it's the 13th chair, and here the numbers certainly aren't coincidental. These refer to Christ and his 12 disciples, and the fact that Van Gogh's chair is the fancier one, the one distinct from all of the others, leaves no doubt as to who was going to be cast in the role of Christ. It's something about the kind of ramshackle construction of these chairs, the collapsed space. Van Gogh never really mastered perspective, give these pictures a kind of poignancy, a sense of emotion that I think his mature portraits kind of fail to generate. It's almost as if Van Gogh, having been rejected and repulsed by almost everybody who he's shown affection to, has decided to transfer his empathy, his emotions, his identification to non-human entities. Where this happens with the most effect is, of course, in his greatest and his most famous and most beloved painting, The Starry Night, from June of 1889, which was painted not in Arles, but in the nearby village of Saint-Rémy, where Van Gogh had committed himself to an insane asylum in May of 1889. The elevated viewpoint in this painting, you can see that there really is no foreground, but rather things in the middle distance jut up abruptly from the bottom edge of the canvas. This has led scholars to believe, or scholars for a long time to believe, that this must have been painted from Van Gogh's bedroom on the second floor of the asylum. He must have been looking through the bars that we know were over his window. That can't be the case, because Van Gogh was not allowed to paint in his bedroom. He was given a room on the first floor to act as his studio, and that would have been where he was painted. But I think it's fair to say that this is meant to recall the artist looking out at the night sky from his bedroom. Another complication, however, is that he scrambled the typography of the surroundings of the asylum. He represents the little town of Saint-Rémy. He represents it as a much smaller little village than it was, kind of huddling up to the mountains. Well, the village and the mountains were on opposite sides of the asylum, so they couldn't have been seen at once. And here Van Gogh places them together and creates a very kind of idealistic view, again, of a little village nestled against the slopes of the mountains. It is not, of course, Van Gogh's treatment of the landscape that is the most extraordinary aspect of this painting, however, but rather the incredible swirling, roiling energy of this night sky, which is illuminated by 10 stars, the planet Venus, which is just to the right of the cypress tree, and a crescent moon. Moreover, great waves of energy seem to be washing across the sky, almost in the form of some kind of tsunami that is breaking right in the middle of the painting. And scholars have wondered what Van Gogh could have been referencing here. Perhaps it was the famed wind of Provence, the Mistral that we know Van Gogh, who liked to paint en plein air, was constantly having to battle with. Others have suggested the Milky Way. It could be that Van Gogh is just referencing some unseen energy in the night sky. The principal question that confronts us with this picture, however, is what could it possibly mean? What is Van Gogh trying to convey to us about this particular vista, or about the night sky, or about the stars? And as you might well expect, a lot of scholarly ink has been spilt on this question. A lot of the attempts to interpret the starry night have entailed connecting the picture to a literary source. verse in everything from the Bible to Walt Whitman to Charles Dickens has been suggested as the literary source for this painting. None too convincing to my mind, because even though, as I said, Van Gogh was incredibly learned and read all the time, he had a lot of time to do that. There's very few instances in which he illustrates an episode from literature. Van Gogh's art was nothing if not personal, and he seems to have been interested very little in giving expression to the visions of others. Van Gogh says very little about this painting in his letters, so they don't help us very much. But we do know that from some of his writings more generally, that Van Gogh associated stars with infinity, which is something that he thought every great work needed to touch upon in some capacity. Great art needed to address infinity. We know also that Van Gogh believed that the only way to ultimately achieve union with infinity was through death. And this was something that he allegorized at least once as a journey to the stars. The year before he painted Starry Night, but he painted another Starry Night earlier, he writes this to Theo. Perhaps death is not the hardest thing in a painter's life. Looking at the stars always makes me dream, as simply as I dream over the black dots representing towns and villages on a map. Why, I ask myself, shouldn't the shining dots of the sky be as accessible as the black dots on the map of France? Just as we take the train to get to Tarascon or Rouen, these are French towns, we take death to reach a star. Thus, on a very fundamental level, I think Starry Night can be read as an allegory of death, or perhaps more precisely, a longing for the release from suffering that will come with death, something that is entirely makes sense for someone in Van Gogh's situation who we know only has another year to live. And such a reading is also supported by that oddly prominent cypress tree that snakes its way up the left edge of the painting, which was often thought of as a symbol of death, both negatively and positively, because the foliage of cypress trees are so dark, they were often associated with death, particularly in Provence, where they kind of blighted the otherwise sun-drenched landscape. And because they were evergreens, they were also associated with death in the form of eternity or the afterlife. And here, I think we would do well to note the similarity, at least in shape, between the cypress tree and the steeple. But also attend to the fact that the cypress tree is so much larger. Here, I think Van Gogh may be trying to say that union with infinity or afterlife is no longer to be achieved through the church or organized religion, but rather the most heartfelt communion with nature is what is going to get you there. Such associations of death and the longed for release of death, I think would also explain what to me anyway is the unmistakably aching, melancholic quality of this picture, which seems to be almost pulsating with energy and emotion. Thus effectively cut off from meaningful communion with his fellow human beings and recognizing that this was likely to be his lot for whatever time he had left, Van Gogh ultimately turned to the stars as his companions, as a source of solace for his almost unbearable loneliness, and ultimately, I think, as the worthy recipients of his enormous capacity to love. In his relationship with the stars, Van Gogh knew that he would not be disappointed. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Andy, for a great talk. If you have any questions, we have some time. If you have questions for Dr. Shelton.
The sunflowers. That would have popped to my mind as being the most famous. This one certainly, but the sunflowers would have been the most famous. How do they fit in what you're talking about?
I would say that the still lives similarly take on a kind of odd emotional quality. They seem to be preternaturally alive, almost able to move. And this could be part of Van Gogh's rethinking his strategy and kind of attaching himself in a more kind of emotional way to things rather than people. But you're absolutely right that at my account, we need to take into account of those as well. They exist in series. There are many versions of those, and Starry Night kind of stands out for its iconic oneness. He did do another painting of a Starry Night when he was in Arles, but it's a much more conventional landscape.
Anyone else with questions?
Since we're talking about empathy, I was wondering if, like, how he portrayed the peasants, he thought them different from himself, or like he thought himself better.
Say that again.
The way he portrayed the peasants is sort of dirty. Do you think he thought of himself as different?
I think he was divided on that. I think because he was living his parents' home and was surrounded by the trappings of conventional bourgeois life, and then he would leave that and go see the peasants and then come back and experience, you know, conventional bourgeois life, which was very different from the way he was living in The Hague. I think that kind of made him of two opinions about the peasants. I think as well, because he was the Potato Eaters was going to be a major work, an important work. I think that caused him to think maybe more conventionally about the peasants. But then when he's actually confronted with one, you know, he's sitting across the room, you know, a couple of feet from them. He treats them, I think, with enormous empathy. And it must have been so strange for those peasants, because Van Gogh was weird and he acted weird and he was different from them. And he was always hanging around and coming into their, kind of interfering in their lives. And I'm almost as much amazed that they would reveal so much of themselves to him as that he was able to capture it. So I think in maybe his more public moments, when he was thinking about like producing something that was going to be seen, he thought of the peasants as these dark others, this black avenging army. But when he was actually there with them and painting directly from them, that what I like to think of his just natural empathy comes through. So I would see there's a big difference to me in the two portraits that I showed and the more ambitious Potato Eaters.
Any other questions?
Yeah, I was wondering if you saw the immersive Van Gogh exhibit and what you thought of that.
Yeah, I can't bring myself to do that. I think that Van Gogh, in the form of his canvases, is a transcendent experience, and I don't need any more. I don't need that to be supplemented. Kudos. I mean, it's very popular and people like to do it, and I can understand why it would appeal to some, but it just is not something that I have experienced.
When did the art world start to notice him? It seems like a lot of his work is in other places. I've been to the one in Amsterdam, the museum. It's wonderful. But I know that a lot of his works is, you know, in other places.
Yep. So earlier than we think, when Van Gogh was still alive, it was late, a very important Symbolist critic, Aurier, wrote about him and kind of established this mystique of Van Gogh as the mad genius. And Van Gogh didn't like it. There were two occasions during his lifetime when somebody wrote favorably of his work. He wrote the critic and said, oh no, so-and-so is so much better than me. Van Gogh is so much better than me. Israel's is so much better than me. And so it seemed that recognition almost made Van Gogh nervous, as if, you know, what should rightly be going to someone else who he considered a better artist was putting him in a kind of compromised position.
There are some questions that have come in online from people that were watching remotely. And one question is, you mentioned Emil Bernard during your talk, and I'm a fan of Bernard. Can you please expand on the relationship between Van Gogh and Bernard? Excellent presentation, thank you.
So Van Gogh met Bernard in Paris, and they were friends for a while. And he was the kind of third wheel in Van Gogh's relationship with Gauguin. I don't think that, well, Bernard was at Van Gogh's funeral, so that they remained in touch. But Bernard and Gauguin, to a certain extent, started to do conventional kind of what Van Gogh saw as kind of conventional religious paintings, and that drove him crazy. And so there was some strain over that. But Bernard, I think, was one of the few people that showed sympathy for Van Gogh, but they had limited interaction.
Thank you. You touched on this, but the question is, how did his contemporaries, other artists and non-artists, view him and his work?
Not very favorably. I mean, some in his most immediate circle did. I don't know that Gauguin had very much respect for Van Gogh at the end of the day. He exploited Van Gogh's adoration. And when I teach them side by side, it's clear whose side I'm on. He wasn't very known. I mean, there, an artist, her portrait, I think, is in the exhibition, purchased a painting by Van Gogh, which is one of his very few sales. But it was largely after he died, but I think almost immediately after he died, that his family was very adept at kind of marketing his work and getting his name out there.
Mm-hmm. What about his relation to later expressionism?
Clearly those artists, like artists who tended to use color very expressionistically and form very expressionistically, I think they got enormous influence from Van Gogh. I don't think I would be qualified to say much more than that, however.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. And I'm going to group a couple questions together. What about his close examination of nature in his many sous-bois paintings? And there's a mention of undergrowth with two figures, mm-hmm. the large lake painting borrowed from Cincinnati in the exhibition. And another person asks, how does that painting, which involves two figures that are quote unquote stuck in the woods or forest, how does that stack up against Starry Night?
Oh, so that's a very late work when he's doing those double wide paintings when he's in Auvers. They've been the source of tremendous scholarly debate because these are the ones that tend to get most intimately connected with Van Gogh's impending suicide, most famously the wheat field with crows. I don't think I've made up my mind about that particular picture. Those figures are very strange, almost kind of, they seem kind of out of place, and it's a strange picture. I mean, Van Gogh spent a lot of time on a landscape. I mean, I think I've mostly looked at his figure paintings and some of his still lives, and obviously this landscape, but I don't have a firm interpretation of that particular picture.
Mm-hmm. I'm just scanning through. A lot of people enjoy the lecture very much and have asked if it is going to be available on the Columbus Museum of Art's YouTube channel, which we plan to put it on. And I believe, unless anyone else has, I think I see one more person, and we can respond.
Hi, thank you. So in regards to Van Gogh and his path almost to fame, it makes me, excuse me, it makes me wonder about artists or art movements that we have today, maybe people that we consider silly as artists or however, does anybody come to mind or any types of art come to mind that could be similar to Van Gogh, his process and the way he was viewed during his lifetime?
Yeah. Unfortunately, I don't think my knowledge of contemporary art is deep enough to be able to kind of point to a contemporary Van Gogh, but you know, this, he's an extreme example of what we expect artists to go through. By definition, we expect them to be misunderstood and neglected, and you know, maybe even die early and tragically, and then they will be discovered as you know, masterpieces. I think a lot of contemporary artists would have a critique of that scenario, and a lot of them are trying to you know, work outside of that. But it's a habit, you know, probably ultimately going back to romanticism, if not further, that is just hard for us to break. But I don't know if anybody else has a suggestion for a kind of contemporary analog to Van Gogh. You know, so you think of somebody like Jackson Pollock. I mean, he was wildly popular almost immediately once he started doing those drip paintings. So it doesn't always work that way. But I think it's still a trope in our imagination of how artists are treated. They have to be ahead of their time, which means they have to be misunderstood. But you know, so many like socially engaged artists, you know, they're kind of working outside of that framework.
Okay. Oh, I think we'll make this our final question then.
I just want to say I appreciate your honesty in not being completely sure about some of the questions, that you're still mulling them in your mind. I really like that a lot. So many people who are, quote, authorities, this is what it is, and there's no questioning, and you really are still thinking about it. That really impressed me.
Well, in full disclaimer, I don't do original research on Van Gogh. I teach him at Ohio State, and I've done that. I do that regularly, and I've thought about him, and I've come to love him. But yeah, I would not presume to say anything too authoritative about him. There are so many others, including the contributors to the catalog, that are much more expert than me, and I've learned greatly from reading their work.
Okay, well, thanks everybody. Thanks once again for coming. Mark, do we have any other outstanding questions online? We can answer, we are able to answer questions online directly to the people who sent them in case there are any additional questions. But thank you all for coming. The exhibition closes on February 6th. So these are the final weeks, and enjoy the rest of your afternoon and evening. Goodbye. Good luck. And thanks, Sandy.